Welcome. Incoming message.
This is the May Contain Action podcast on Apple iTunes, Spotify, Google Play, and more.
3, 2, 1, 0. All systems active.
Everyone to season 2 of the May Contain Action podcast, the world's number one gaming podcast and content creation podcast that is specifically hosted by a Major League Baseball player and a headphone model. Support for the May Contain Action podcast is brought to you by Manscaped, the best in men's below the belt grooming. Grooming below your belt. I'm your lovely host number one, Paul, aka Action Jackson. Round of applause. Waiting for that. Put that in post. There's more. There's more people. We'll put that in post. My lovely host number two, if you will, kind of my Vanna White of the podcast. Host number two, Trevor Mays here, everybody.
That's the first Vanna White comparison. I tap the letters.
Tap the letters.
Turn around.
Show me an E. Go ahead and hit
there's
it.
One.
Nice.
There's one.
Nice. Excellent work.
It's one E.
Really could. We're hiring for new Vanna White. But before we introduce our guest today, Trevor, show me an S. That's an Easter egg. There's an Easter egg for our guest. Anyway, the point is, before I introduce our guest, I'd like to welcome you all to the May Contain Action Twitch channel. Don't forget to follow, turn on notifications so you never miss a live show. We record all of our podcasts live over at twitch.tv/May Contain Action. Head over there right now, hit pause on the podcast, and go do it. I won't wait. I'm moving on. But today, our very special guest, I asked for an S, a little Easter egg for those smart enough to pick it up. Special Call of Duty world champion, the one man army himself, who has been remained off camera screen literally in the Discord call this entire time because we told him that we want him to act like he's not in the room and then walk in. None other than Silly is here, everybody. Woo!
All right.
Yes,
there he is. Special entrance.
Look at that.
Glad to be here. Glad to be here.
Scooted,
man. What's up?
Scooted right in.
What is up?
How you doing, man?
I'm great. Just relaxing at home, playing video games. Beta came out today, so just been grinding.
It did. COD beta came out today. I didn't get to play it once. I've been so busy. How is it?
It's good. After playing it on PlayStation 4 for a little while, and then playing on PC, it's night and day. Way more enjoyable.
Really?
Yeah. Way better.
Oh, wow. Mm. Like way better in. Well, in what way? Like, what makes it better?
Instead of having my 60 frames, I have 200 frames. Better ping. Better lobbies. It just looks better all around.
I hear that, guys? Better. Just spend astronomically more money, and you'll have better performance.
Exactly. That's all it takes. It's a better community. Better people in general.
And makes it's way easier sense. To cheat. Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to go there.
Whoa. Come on.
My bad. It was just a joke, dude.
Turn off that script.
We're all joking here. Trevor. We're joking here on the pod, dude. Just a joke.
We're a bunch of silly guys. Hey!
Right. I did another that. One. Another one.
Another one. We really did it. Well, Silly, I want to get right to it. I want to get to know a little bit more about you. First of all, again, thanks for coming to the podcast. We really appreciate it, despite the technical difficulties. PM, that's on you. That's on
sorry.
You. But Silly, we want to know. Well, actually, I want to know a little bit more your name. So this isn't some. Well, this is actually something we ask every single time. But I'm especially curious about yours. Where does your name come from, Silly? How did that get started? And if it wasn't, what was the first online presence screen name you had when you were coming up?
So my very, very first name ever, first gamer tag, was Justin Fargo. For obvious reasons, I really couldn't stick with that gamer tag, you know. When I was about 13 playing COD 4, I played with like my older friends all the time, and they'd call me like they'd call me Silly Goose because I was like the younger one and I had a little squeaky voice. So you know, it took the goose off.
Yeah.
Silly, and I've kept it for the last 12 years.
That is adorable. That is the most wholesome way to get a nickname ever. That's fantastic.
Yeah, that's funny that you were the younger one, so they called you Silly Goose. There's so much worse things to be called.
There's you know so, I mean? Like a group of like older kids were like, you know what's really going to put him in his place? Silly Goose. They're like, yeah.
They were surprisingly nice to me, you know. My friends my age were a little bit more rude, obviously, but...
Yeah. Yeah,
that's amazing. I love that.
When was it always the two capital L's for the silly?
I had
that
for
something you kind of just like spice it up with.
Actually, yeah, I had the capital L's, everything capital except for the I, but I kind of dropped that off and I just do just like a capital S now.
Okay.
But you know, changing with age.
Gotcha. Yeah, I could see how there was a phase We're changing the middle letters to caps was cool, and you're like, wow, that's actually just not cool anymore.
Yeah.
So we're just gonna go straight up, you know, just like, you know, I changed my names and now my name's I'm Trevor May, but
yeah,
I can do that because, you know, I have all the other personal information blocked for the other because I've played baseball for so long. So
mm-hmm.
I was protected already, but I completely understand why you can't just make your name your name now.
You know, Trevor, I feel like the more you bring up the fact that your personal information is like protected, the more you egg on people to try to figure out your personal.
Hey, don't,
like you're challenging,
don't try to find me.
Everybody and who listens to this.
You
like,
send me something to sign, I'm not gonna sign it. See, now there's no incentive. There we go. I'm keeping it.
I don't know,
it's my dollar card you bought.
He might. sorry. No one's gonna, you'll be fine. You'll be very safe. Well, that's actually a really concise. Like, you're like, hey, this is how it happened. This is a silly goose turned to silly. And that, like, usually there's like some sort of like very weird development or evolution of a name of like, I put this backwards and I saw a Coke can and then now I'm donkey teeth. And it's like, what the hell did that even happen? Yours is very straightforward.
Yeah, perfect. Well, I've been telling it a lot recently, so I've perfected it.
Oh, yikes.
You've been playing professionally or semi-professionally for a very long time though, right? So like you've had like incentive to keep that same name, right? Like,
yeah,
10 years,
I,
right? Like 10 years you've been playing COD professionally?
Yeah, I've been pro on and off because obviously like it wasn't worth it. You know, mm-hmm. when I was like 18, it wasn't worth it like financially to play it full time and try and do that. So I would kind of play on and off. I finally came back when it was starting to blow up a little bit, but my first pro tournament was in 2009.
Wow. Dang.
So yeah, it's been a long time.
What tell us about that. Where was that? Like when, how like legit was the setup? Like how nice were those folding chairs?
So it was at the Anaheim Convention Center. It was COD 4 Nationals in 2009. Mm-hmm. My team got second place in the pro circuit ladder before that, and then I snuck on to like one team that had one spot open, and I was like the youngest player at the tournament. I think it was like 13 or 14.
Wow.
And we obviously, I mean, we didn't do great. We got last place out of six teams, but I mean, the setup was all right. Obviously not a ton of prize money, but yeah, we were playing on folding chairs. We didn't even see any main stage action, but
oh,
you know, it was pretty fun. A good experience.
Dude, those are so fun. I remember I got to my first like actual gaming like convention where everyone just like came from different places was MLG Anaheim. Actually, I'm sorry. It was MLG. No, it was Anaheim. Yeah, it was actually at the Anaheim Convention Center, which is beautiful, by the way. The whole area is beautiful. And it was so surreal that that was even happening. That was still like fairly new-ish. It was like 2013 when all these things were still happening. And like, I remember telling everyone, like even my friends who are like the same age, like, hey, I'm going to Anaheim to like an event. And they're like, why? Like, why would you? It doesn't make any sense. But just like the energy that's there and all the kid, like everyone in that pit, like they just put you like a pit for like almost open bracket or something, was so high energy and everyone was so focused. And it was like actually really cool. It was all the tenacity you would see in normal sports that I wasn't exposed to at that time with esports within COD. And I was like, damn, these kids are taking this seriously. This is amazing. So you were like almost a part of that pit. Like, did you, were you go through those rounds and whatever?
In 2013, I was in that pit at that event, I'm pretty sure. So
really?
The smelly gamer passion pit. Yeah. All your backs are touching each other, chair to chair.
Dude,
screaming at each other. Yeah, it's definitely an experience. I'm glad I'm out of it now in hindsight, but it was definitely fun for, in the meantime.
That was the best part, actually, was the random outbursts from people. Because, like, you don't hear the audio. It's all through headphones. So it's, like, dead quiet. You just, like, hear, like, very faint, subtle breathing. And all of a sudden, someone's like, get sucked on, kid! Like, out of nowhere. And you're like, I don't even know it. I'm just trying to get
flip
a
table.
At Starbucks. And all of a sudden, this kid's like, yeah.
Who has a, someone has a video. I think it's Legion has a video. Like, he played in a tournament with his brother. They did, like, a duo tournament. But, like... Yeah. Someone's video taking care, so he made the YouTube video not from his gameplay, just from the camera of him playing, and you can't hear any of the audio, but you know him, he's always talking, so he's like, he's got his headphone on, he's just loud talking the other team, no one's talking but him, he's like, yeah you gotta hide behind the box, and he's just screaming at them, and they're like just to his right, it's so funny. It's great.
You just hear like a dull, like a just talking to you the entire time. Like that does absolutely get in your head. I'm sure it does.
Yeah. If anything, it's irritating. Like to hear it over and over again. You're like, nah, like, you know, screw this guy. I got to beat him. But
yeah. That gets you fired up.
Oh my gosh.
So cool. Paul, I didn't know you got to play in a LAN.
Well, I played like for fun slash like they're like, hey, if you want to like play and whatever and like sit down and like have a team, like sure, like we got crushed, it was like not even close, but I was like, I'll try it out, I'll sit in the chair that 30 other young men have sat in that no one has cleaned for the past 4 hours, like sure, that sounds great. But it was so hot, they just had fans going, but it was like I don't know if they had fans going, so but yeah, it was a ton of fun. It was a very, very cool experience. So you mentioning that your first one was at Anaheim is nostalgic for me as well. When you were through that process though, and you got on and kind of, you said you went kind of pro, you took a break because Infinite Warfare. and then you came back. When did you decide that you could kind of take it full time? Like when did you, what was the turning point in which you're like, I'm going to do this full time. This is the gig.
At the end of Black Ops 2, I kind of quit for a little bit. During Advanced Warfare, I was working full time and I was in school and I was trying to play. We got our first salaried like position on a team then. We're making $500 a month. So like that combined with my job and going to school, I was like, all right, this is cool. Like I'm going to grind this out, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. And once Infinite Warfare came around, there was about like a 100% salary increase amongst all the pro league teams.
Nice.
That's when I was like, all right, well, you know, I can put most of my time into this now, you know, it's sustainable. And, you know, I wasn't like, it's one thing if you're like a 15-year-old kid playing, that's like, you know, you're good to go making $500 living at your parents' house. But I was already I was like 20, like 19 or 20. So I'm like, all right, well, I got to make sure I'm actually making like the big bucks off of it until like, you know, I put all my effort into it.
That's amazing.
Like, that's like $12,000 a year, guys. That's like. Full time, but again, like, you know, you're living with whatever. I remember when I was 20, I was living with like seven people in a house in like a five bedroom.
Yes.
You know, like, that's what, to be honest, no one played games, but we could have very easily been a gamer house. It could have been very easily been a gamer house. So, yeah, it's kind of like living in a frat.
Missed opportunity there, Trev.
Yeah. I should have started playing earlier. Maybe I'd be better at games. Yeah.
You could have been the race. You could have been you.
Could have been me.
Opportunity,
but it's
there.
Not, you know, missed opportunities, man. They're everywhere. They're everywhere. And so what year was that?
2014, 2015 is when I like started to really get back into it. And then when all the pros like realized it was like it could be a full-time thing, it was probably like 2017, because it like before that, if you weren't winning like half the events, you weren't making any money. So
so
it's only been like a few years.
Like 10% were making like real.
Yeah, probably like the top 5 or 10% of players altogether were making like any kind of real money. Yeah.
And then
so you would
then
go ahead,
Paul. No, you got
it. I was gonna say, you made a base salary and then any winnings on top of that you guys split, right?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. It was a split four ways, and most orgs take a little cut, whether it be 10% up to like 40%, just kind of depends on who you play for.
Mother of God.
Yeah.
That's a large range.
Yeah, it is.
Well, yeah, you got to remember, sometimes some orgs would, like, you know, put you in team houses, and then, like, so living was free. I mean, yeah. That was kind of right. That's kind of like they would give you, like, there's other perks. You get, like, a free chair and a free computer and a free, you know, like, bro, all your stuff you use is free. So we're going to take a higher
percentage. 40%?
And when in reality, that's not a great deal.
There's some orgs that, like, you know, let's say you don't have another offer and you have one team to go to, they might just strong arm you and say, all right, well, we're going to take 40% from you. We're not going to pay for your housing. This is back then, obviously not now, but.
Oh, God, is this happening?
We're going to take 40% and, you know, you have no other team offer. So that's it. We're taking 40%. Boom.
It's a crapshoot, dude. Gosh. It was there's still a little bit of a crapshoot going around.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Seen on smaller Twitter. Places.
Yeah. Dude, silly. Yeah. Blink twice if you're okay in your organization.
I'm great in mine. Fantastic.
I'm just imagining, like, 40% cut, 40% cut plus 40% roughly in taxes. Like, yikes. That is.
Yeah. Yeah. You're getting robbed.
Yep. It's absolutely rough.
Sorry. Yeah. I take back what I said. It's not $12,000 a year.
Yeah. $40 and a gas card. That's what you get.
Let's go.
Sign me up. And then you were playing professionally when the COD, like the franchise league, right? Was that like a really exciting announcement for you guys? That can imagine, like, the community, the guys who've been around for a long time. Like, this is it. Was that like a big?
Yeah, it was actually rumored for a long time. Everybody's like, they're not going to franchise. Like, we don't have any, like, anything proof. We have no proof. Like,
yeah.
Then when the franchising announcement came, everybody was super excited because, you know, it's the closer you get to, like, a traditional sports format, I feel like is the absolute best thing for anything esports related. Mm-hmm. And, you know, being able to represent a city and having, like, hometown fans and stuff like that is just, like, an awesome experience because in previous years, like, 90% of the fans were dominated by the Optic brand. So it doesn't matter who you were, what team you played for when you played Optic, the crowd's cheering for Optic. And that obviously changed up with, like, the home series events and things like that.
Oh, good.
I thought about that. That's freaking awesome.
Yeah.
That is pretty sweet. That's a really cool part about, I mean, I think that's one of the biggest, that's why I was a huge supporter of franchising esports from the outset too, just because of that fact, because people just love where they're from and, like, love to cheer for the team, even if they don't even watch the esport or the game really, or play it even. Like, for example, you as a member of the Rocker, I know that recently that changed, and you're now with LA, correct? But you're at the Rocker. For first of all, the minority owner of the Rocker, Gary V, is like my man. And then, you know, I'm a Minnesota athlete, and I just got your sweatshirts and I got your hat, and we're all the guys in the Twins, because we all got care packages from her name's Midnight, right? Midnight sent it over, and you know, we were all just rocking your stuff on the plane. That was super cool. I was like, and I got to meet the local 2K team too, that ended up winning the ship in 2019. So that was super cool. I kind of became that, like, connection between these local esports teams and such, and it was just cool to, like, see all my teammates wearing your stuff and, you know, cheering you on. It was pretty dope. Everyone's playing COD now, so it was awesome.
Yeah, that is awesome. We definitely appreciate that. And one thing I can add is that, like, Minnesota fans were pretty diehard for us in terms of, like, following the Rocker and stuff. So I hope the LA fans can keep up and kind of, you know, really rep the home team. But
let's go.
You know,
getting called out. Let's go, LA. I know, well, we got the Lakers, but, you know, let's see it. You know, LeBron's easy to root for. Let's spread it around.
Is he easy to root for?
I mean, for a lot of people, it is.
It's apparently very difficult to root for LeBron for some reason.
I don't know. I got to say, this random tweet I saw yesterday that made me really laugh. But they said, well, the Lakers won the NBA Finals, but Dak hurt his ankle. It was a tough day to be a Yankees fan. And I was like, that's hilarious, because everyone loves, anyone who's a Yankees fan also loves the Lakers and also loves the Dallas Cowboys.
Oh, it's,
you
yes.
Get it? You get
100%.
It?
I get
it's
it.
It's Tim. It's I Tim. Get it.
It's Tim. It comes up every episode. That's not, you know what, dude? I'm going to steal this one, dude. I'm going to steal this one, silly. Usually this is a Trevorism. I'm going to take it.
Okay, yeah, you can go for it.
This one's mine, dude.
Fine,
so I'm going to explain this as close as Trevor can explain this question I have for you. Okay, dude, so let's imagine for a second you're back, you're silly goose, okay? So you're playing some games, you got your buds, you know, they're older than you. They're, you know, they're clowning you a little bit, but you're also kind of fighting back, like you're doing well. Boom. 5 hours go by. You guys are famished. You're thirsty. You're hungry. You think to yourself, man, I need to quench this. I need sustenance to keep gaming so hard. You start going through the list of different restaurants and places you could possibly go and eat. Imagine that. Freeze that. Fast forward. You're silly. Just got off the plane from a really intense match. Come home. You took the dub. You got the trophy right in your hand. And you're like, man, I should celebrate with some delicious, delicious food. In both cases, where do you go?
Oh man, do you really want to know what I was eating when I was 13?
110%.
Yes, you do.
I probably would have went in the fridge, grabbed an amp, a couple packs of Gushers.
Yep.
And went back and sat in my sweaty gamer chair.
No actual food.
No actual food. The only actual food was maybe for lunch. That's it.
Original amp, like the Mountain Dew flavored
green
amp.
Green one, yes. Yes. The Mountain Dew flavored amp. That's all I used to drink. That was my absolute favorite.
Yes.
Amp and Gushers.
That was Wild Berry Skittles. That's me, bro.
Dude.
Yes.
That was like half my diet, probably. Probably drink more amp than I did water.
Oh, gosh, so bad for you. Other nowadays, countries just shaking their head at us like these kids. Sugar water and sugar pellets, like squishy sugar pellets.
He's going to go, nowadays it's going to just be like salad.
Now it's sushi. That's usually my go-to, my celebration. I live by Nobu. In LA, I live by Sugarfish. You know, if I win a big tournament, I'm going to one of those places for sure. No debate.
Wow. Sushi. I love it. That's fantastic. Are you a fan of the poke bowl? Am I saying that right? The
poke bowl.
Yes. Actually just ate something similar for lunch, so definitely.
Incredible. I love that. All right. Now, this is kind of what we typically will steer towards, because those are two excellent responses. Sushi is fantastic. You actually seem like quite the high class fellow. You're like, I usually go for a sushi place, like a local. I don't know either of those two places you mentioned, by the way. They could be chains. I don't know.
Like the most famous LA,
upstate New York. Like there's not, we just got Chick-fil-A. Everyone lost their mind. There's nothing.
I mean, if you talk to Courage or Nate Shot for 5 minutes, it's been mentioned.
Okay. I see everybody post the pictures of their to-go boxes that they get at Sugarfish right now because you can't go inside. It's delivered. It's like $80 and has like all their like fresh sushi in like a big like display box. Really, really cool. Yeah.
Beautiful. I heard they have their own. Oh, so they have the restaurant and then they have like a distribution restaurant that's not open to the public that is only for the deliveries. Like delivery.
So cool.
Yeah. They had to open up another restaurant that's not actually a restaurant because they get ordered so much.
Wow. So they're doing just fine.
Yeah, they're doing just fine.
Sugarfish. All right. When I go there in 2042, when this is over, I will be sure to hit that place up.
Also, just before we move on, when we get past COVID and you're able to travel again to play your COD, when the franchise leagues actually get to play in their home cities, finally, like 2 years into their leagues, when you actually get to do that, when you come up and play the Surge in Seattle, go to Shiro Sushi.
Shiro. All right. That's actually the only city I've ever lived in other than Vegas is Seattle. So I've had quite a few places out there. Never that one. I'm down.
Or Sushi Kashiba. That's his Shiro. Kashiba is the guy's name. That's his, like, I went there the other day and it's like, give me $100 and I'll just give you whatever I want to give you. And you're like, okay, yes, sir.
Oh, you don't even pick. He just hands you food.
It's omakase. He just brings it like two pieces at a time. Like, they just keep bringing it out like over and over and over and over and over and over.
Just like
and
then
they explain what it is. Yeah. And you just eat it. You just say, yes, sir, and you eat it.
When I go to the local Ponderosa, it just gives me chicken wings from the underneath the heat lamp as I want.
What the hell is a Ponderosa?
I mean, it's kind of the same.
Same. Yeah. Same.
Old country buffet. Fancy sushi.
Old country buffet.
Old country buffet. Mac and cheese is great. Silly, your favorite fast food, however, because I'm sure you probably have something like that every now and then. Like, what's your favorite?
I'm actually a really big In-N-Out fan. I don't know if it's because I was raised by one. A lot of people hate on it, but if I had the option between Shake Shack, Five Guys, In-N-Out, I'm always going to In-N-Out. Always.
We got another In-N-Out. What's that, half?
Really strong opinions. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. A lot less Five Guys than I would have imagined, but I think most of the people we have on the show actually are from the, either from or live on the West Coast. So Five Guys is not Texas. Very often.
And or everything's Texas. In Texas. Yeah. So
all the Texas people are like, I like beef and cheese. Nothing
or,
else.
Yeah,
my
they'll
burger.
Say Whataburger. Yeah. Or they'll, if they grew up in Texas, they'll say Whataburger. But anyone who's like a transplant from somewhere else that like moved to Austin because of the fiber internet, they're like In-N-Out or Chick-fil-A. Most of the time.
Yeah,
and I think Five Guys is just solid, bro. I think it's like everyone's number three. Like if there's one and they're like, I want a burger, and that's it, it's the closest. I don't think anyone dislikes Five Guys. I just don't think it's anyone's favorite.
My favorite for yours. So, shut the actual hell up, Trevor. I'd be considered doing that.
I can't explain it, bro. I'm going by the data.
Yeah, think about what you're explaining and then shut the hell up about it.
Okay, my bad.
Thanks. Five Guys.
Why do we do this? Why do we do this show together? You know what I mean? Like people are like, they don't even like each other. Like yeah, you're right. We just don't need the Vanna White. Locked in now.
I need a and Vanna White.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah. Goodbye well, for revealing the numbers.
All right. Moving on to the next question. You know, we don't have the most time in the entire world, so
okay, I'm out of here.
You've been doing pro Call of Duty for 10 years, and now that you know, you said around 2017 is when it really kicked up, and you've been doing it full time, like full time. What's one thing you wish you would have known kind of about how it was all going to play out before? Like what's one tip you give to someone who to say there's a 14-year-old out there that once is like, yo, I want to be a professional at a game. What's one tip you would give them in order to like maybe make their life a little bit easier, or maybe help them learn something that they don't have to learn themselves?
Man, if I could go back, might sound a little harsh, but I would definitely prioritize gaming over a lot of my friendships and especially any relationships I have when I was younger. Absolutely.
Wow.
They hindered my growth a lot in terms of, you know, how much I played. I had girlfriends that didn't want me to play. You know, you always have people, especially, you know, 5 or so years ago when esports wasn't, you know, blown up to how it is, like, you know, why you're sitting in front of your game all day, where's that going to get you?
Yeah.
But, definitely would have powered through. Would have grinded a lot more than I did, would have prioritized this, made it my first priority, but you know, obviously hindsight is 20/20.
Yeah.
Wow. It's not a thing we hear often is like, yeah, honestly, I would have been like, honestly, everyone I used to talk to, I would have played games more.
You got to remember though, it wasn't what it is now, right? The content wasn't what it, like the whole content creation space is just like blown up ridiculously, especially in the last 3 or 4 years. Like just,
yeah.
It's become something, you know, paralleling with it's become like an integral part of pop culture now. And no one expected that to happen. We always, you know, so that it's a little easier to say that. But that is, yeah, that's the first time I think to paraphrase, and correct me if I'm wrong, maybe if you really want to do something, go for it. Like if you really, like really enjoy doing something, don't worry about the stuff that maybe not is
opinions of others
important to you. Yeah, I mean, yeah, the opinions of others and really give it a shot. And that way you won't at least regret it. Even if it turns out to not be what you wanted, at least you went for it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Perfect.
Wow.
Awesome. I'm glad.
We really get silly.
We really get them.
We really get them. We understand. same level. I love it. You're just like, yeah, I had a bunch of girlfriends. They all sucked. really wish I did more multiplayer. I mean,
yeah, dude, honestly, like, I have all the same, like all my best friends are the same best friends I've had since I was younger. So like if I could have just cut that entire block of the girlfriends that I'm not obviously not marrying, I would, you know, I would have been way better off currently. But, you know, it's all good. It's all good.
I love
it. Sounds like you're specifically talking about girlfriends. Like it feels like, you know, you at first you were like, it could be any relationship. And then you're like, and it's girls. It's freaking girls, guys. Girls aren't worth it.
It's definitely when you're younger. I will agree with that. Don't think so, but there was some friends too that, you know, pick on you for being the one that doesn't want to go out with your friends and that want to play video games and stuff, but you know,
yeah,
they're the smaller part of it.
That is incredible. I honestly, that's a good amount of wisdom right there. You're like, honestly, obviously they're not my wife, so it didn't work out, so I don't know why I wasted that time.
That is exactly that's the goal, right? Yeah. Once you know you're not the one.
Exactly.
World of Warcraft it is. See you later.
Back on COD.
Back on
How
COD.
Old are you, silly? How old do you know?
I just turned 25.
Awesome.
I'm actually the youngest of the current players that were pro when I was first pro. I'm the youngest of the three remaining, pretty sure. So.
Oh, wow.
Not too bad. Yeah.
Nice.
Who are the three remaining? Or who are the other two?
Unless my counting is off, I'm pretty sure it's just me, Crim6, and Clayster. Pretty sure.
No. Oh.
How old's Scump?
Oh, I was going to say Scump. Is
he started, he went pro in Modern Warfare 2. So he was a year later than the initial game, but I think he might be a little bit younger than me.
Okay.
Pretty sure.
But yeah, 25 in gaming years.
I mean,
73.
Wow. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Like dog years.
It's a random side question because I know we got to, you know, we want to keep you on a time crunch here, but I've always wanted to know, is the Huntsman, are they named after Scump? Is that
ask him
a thing?
Are they named after Scump? What do you mean?
Isn't his last name Huntsman?
His last name Huntsman? No. His last name is Abner.
I don't know. Yeah. I think we're going to have to check on that. PM, can you
do that? I have no idea what you're talking about. That.
I'm pretty sure. Can't wait to have him on the podcast.
Yeah. They named the organization after him. Yeah. They totally did that.
I mean, that's a really badass last name if it was true, Trevor. Okay.
Even with the pros' advice in this.
Okay, you know, PM, whatever, bro. I need to get an independent fact checker on that. You guys are wrong.
Might be.
Stupid, dude. See? Thank you.
That's hilarious. That's really funny.
Oh, my gosh. I got to pull this up, dude.
If you want to just, like, blow past this extreme embarrassment, you could just hit us with the Manscaped ad.
Dude, for some reason... I can't get my Cliff Notes to load, dude. I don't know why. I need the process. I've literally, that's insane. I've never had this happen before. It's fine. Today's episode of the podcast, episode 42B? I don't know. Episode 43.
42's lost forever. You're never going to see it again. Forever.
Literally never, ever again.
No one even knows what happened.
It is brought to you by Manscaped. Come on, guys. You're sitting at home. You're bored. Quarantine. Nothing's open, really. I mean, you're still doing takeout. You're probably sitting there playing with your balls anyway. Manscaped is here to help you clean hygiene those babies and trim them up. Manscaped is your go-to brand for below-the-waist grooming and hygiene. The perfect package 3.0 is really... what you need to know includes the Manscaped trimmer, which forever changed the grooming game. The third generation trimmer features a cutting edge ceramic blade to reduce grooming accidents thanks to the advanced skin safe technology pioneered by Manscaped. Not only do they obsess over technology developments to provide you with the best tools for your grooming experience, but they also use the best ingredients in their formulations. Inside the perfect package, you also find a crop preserver, ball deodorant, and of course, beautiful Manscaped Lawnmower 3.0. Probably sitting on the couch, just smelling gross after quarantine. Take a shower, Jeff. Go shave your balls while you're at it because that thing is water resistant, baby. You use that in the shower and the LED light guides your way. You got a dark cave for a shower? Just water slowly dripping on your shoulder because you haven't paid your water bill, Jeff? It's all right. LED on the front of that Manscaped trimmer will just zip, zip, zip. Make that nice and easy. You can see everything you need to see, dude. Subscribe to the perfect package and get a new replacement blade for that Lawnmower 3.0 delivered to your door every 3 months, making sure you're always fresh and hygienic. For a limited time, subscribers get not one, but two free gifts. The Shed Travel Bag. A delightful little bag you can stuff all your goodies in, including the lawnmower, to take with you on your long trips. I'm kidding. No one's going anywhere. It's quarantine. They also added the patented high-performance anti-chafing Manscaped boxers, which I wear often. This is the perfect package for your perfect package. Get 20% off and free shipping with code MCA at manscaped.com. That's code MCA. manscaped.com. 20% off your order and free shipping. Do yourself a favor and always use the right tools for the job. Moving right along.
Nice, Jeff.
I might have to buy one now. Wow.
Ah, God, Jeff. Love that.
Jeff.
I'll tell you one thing. No one skipping this ad. When they're what, listen to it later. Everyone's like, no. We gotta listen to the whole thing. What's he say this time? Which is the point.
That's how you
I'm gonna be honest. There's some podcasts that are like, all right, we're gonna take a 19-minute break to read you 13 different brand things. And you're like,
but
if Paul read them and made them up, I would listen.
I would love that. That'd be great if we just got like a random ad and I just got to ad lib it every week. That'd be pretty fantastic. Actually.
That would be great.
I'd really enjoy that.
Man, all we need is some ads.
Exactly.
As he looks in the camera.
We're leading money.
Awesome. Moving on. We have two very important questions that are very specific to you, Silly. Now we pretty much ask everybody those first five, but these are just yours. And this is a very, very, I'm so excited to hear this answer. And I'm sure it's going to be very concise and well thought out. First question. And this is going to be very interesting to hear from a professional. Skill-based matchmaking. Thoughts?
All right.
He's so tired of answering this question.
I wouldn't care so much about the skill-based matchmaking if, like, I'm fine with playing against people that are good. Cool. Like, I'm still gunning them. That's fine.
Yeah.
But why do the worst players in the lobby end up on my team? Why do I have teammates that are 0-22 and all six people on the other team in pubs are all positive? How is that fair at all?
It should averaging be like, your numbers.
Maybe it is averaging.
So if I have 50 kills and they have 4, how is that an average? I feel like that's a extreme to an extreme. Like it doesn't work a lot of the time. And it makes Warzone unbearable.
Yeah, Warzone's really hard, I'm sure.
This happens to you like often in lobbies.
Yeah, especially like when I've been even playing the beta, it keeps happening. Like I'll have like a party of like 3 or 4 good people, and then our other two teammates have 0 score for 7 minutes. I'm just like, bro, like please help me. Ow. Like we're losing. I have no idea. They just put the absolute worst people they can find in our lobby because we're bros, I guess.
That's so this is why this is so interesting. This is why I wanted to hear it from you. So pretty much everyone we hear and the we know is like a content creator, right? They're good. They're good in terms of the entire scope of everyone who plays the game. They're good players. People who go pub stomp all day. And they're complaining because they don't want to match up against you. Like they're afraid of matching up against you. So they're like, matching up with your pros or people who are like semi-pro.
This guy's
like,
dropping 50 a game. Like how is he in my lobby?
Like still killed me 17 times in a row. But they still won, but they had a bad time. Because they died so many times to you. So it's weird. Like, nobody's winning except for the guy that you carried. Like, he's
the only one. But he's the only person enjoying it.
Really, yeah, exactly.
This isn't fun because I'm 4-17. But I won, but I didn't feel like I won. So, like, nobody's winning. And it's really interesting that, like, you're like, I just keep getting matched up because the average of our SBMM is like putting us against this group, but they're like a 5-stack and they're all excited about like, and they're calming and I'm just by myself with 4 guys who don't know what they're doing. And that sounds awful. And it sounds awful from the other perspective too. So it just doesn't sound like it's great from any direction.
Yeah. Like I'll get kills, you know, but I don't want to lose the game and I'll lose by a couple points or something. Yeah. And I have the guy sitting 30 feet away from a 70-inch plasma screen TV with his TV audio going 4-37 and we lose by 3 points. And I'm just like, come on, bro. Like you got to give me something.
I'm imagining a dude with a 70-inch like plasma that he just bought, but he's sitting on an ottoman. You know what I mean?
Yes. Literally, like a theater chair in his living room,
fold out chair,
Corona in hand, just torching my wins.
He's like, they're at B, but you can hear him echoing through his own speaker,
through his room,
through his Sonos that he also bought just to do this with. Oh God, get some Astros, right, Paul?
That's what I'm saying, dude. Quality engineering in these things. Oh yeah, dude. Silly knows what's up, baby.
Got my logo on there.
There's a logo on there. God, I'm slipping. I need my own logo. Dang it.
I mean, well, you are the face of the company. I don't know how you don't have your own logo. True.
Not sure if Silly's seen my ads, but they're pretty good.
They are pretty good. I will give you that.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I bought these with my own money, and no one gives me that. All right. Second question. a little less controversial, I think. I think this should be, it kind of expands on something we've already asked. You are a Call of Duty World Champion 2018. Never take it away. His name will always be on that trophy. But not only that, you actually got to play a championship, I'm assuming, in person, like, because it was pre-COVID, which was pretty cool, I'm assuming. So what I want to know is, like, what's it like to not only play on the big stage, like, for a championship, but then win it? Because I have my own experiences with, like, you know, playing in front of people, but I've never got to do, like, the Fortnite Pro-Am. I've never actually got to play a video game, like, in that like atmosphere. So take us through it. Like what's a huge moment you remember? Like, what's like a momentum shifting moment where you're like, dude, we're gonna win this, like, we got this. Is there anything specific you can remember, like something you'll never forget?
Yeah, so the big momentum shift, we actually at World War II champs, we played like the best team on finals, in the grand finals, and we were in winners, so we had to play two best of fives. We ended up getting reverse swept in the first one. So going into the next series, we picked their best map first, and we're like, all right, we win this, we win the series. Boom, beat them on that map. After that, it was done. They didn't win another map the entire time. That was our big momentum shift. We're like, all right, it's done. Like, after we won the first map, we're like, done. They're not going to win another map. It's over. And then, you know, confetti hitting your face, lifting up the huge 50-pound trophy, and then, you know, it's all
50
history.
50 pounds.
Yeah,
it's pretty hefty.
Hell, right?
The champs one is pretty hefty. Yeah, it's a big trophy. They're like, make sure you guys all lift it up together.
What is that, the Stanley Cup? Good lord.
No, it's hilarious because I think the OWL one's gigantic, and the League of Legends one weighs like 85 pounds. And they're like, oh, it was like five small Korean guys. And they're like, I don't know if we can lift it.
I don't know if
you can lift it.
They like one guy like get underneath it, and the other four are like, ah, yeah, okay, put it down. Like, because they're gonna drop it. So you picked their best map because you knew that if you could take them down on it, it was kind of like almost reverse psychology. Like, they like, oh, we can do this, and then you just crush them. At that point, if they lost that map, you knew that their spirits would be crushed.
Oh yeah, it was done. It was done. That was like their for sure map, like for them to win, it was done. Right after that.
Wow, dude, and you win that, and you know the confetti's going off. Like, I don't know, kind of like, can you explain like that feeling? Because I've never won like anything MLB wise, and I've never won anything for like competition really. I got to sectionals in high school and basketball, and we lost. So like, there's nothing, no big like thing. So what's that emotion like? What's that feeling?
The context of it too, we actually didn't qualify for playoffs right before that. We didn't place well enough to qualify. So we had all this time to prepare our strats and stuff. So we prepared to hard counter all the good teams that we could have ran into pretty much. And, after not qualifying for the, I don't know, what was it? Like probably a $1 million tournament before that. And then winning the biggest one was just like a huge, you know, huge championship for us. My like duo assault, that was his first event win ever, and he also got the MVP. So it was like, it's the best feeling in the world. Like, there's, you know, nothing compares to it in the realm of esports or Call of Duty. Like, the world championships, everything, you know, there's only like 20 or so winners. And you know, until I win another one of those, that feeling will continue to go unmatched.
Wow.
How do you guys celebrate after? Like, is there like, I understand some of the guys are underage. You know, there's not like bottle popping, right? But you know, like, we would go back to our locker room and just spray crap everywhere and jump around and, you know, enjoy it. Is there anything like that? Like, or do you guys like dinner? Yeah.
They're kind of underage. Like, actually, all of us were over 21 on that team. We were the oldest team to win champs, I'm pretty sure.
Oh, awesome.
Okay, but cool. You know, we went back, I had a couple of drinks, was tired from waking up at 7 a.m. or whatever we did a play, had like two drinks, I fell asleep, and I woke up with strep throat. But you know, at least someone champs, that's all
at
that matters.
At least you're a champion, dude. At least you're a champ. Never take it away.
I was in school at that time too, and I was trying to study for my final at our boot camp before we had to go to champs, and I went home, won champs, failed both my finals. It was like, all right, well, I guess I'm gonna take some time off of school, you know, until I'm done playing. But yeah, you know, everything else kind of sucked, but it obviously was outweighed by winning.
Failed both finals.
I mean, how are you supposed to study and prepare to win champs? Like, it's just a lot.
Yeah,
which is crazy. That's a crazy dynamic that, like, it's just like, I could, for example, people could be like, hey, bro, can you do this and this and this and this for me? Like, nah, we're in the playoffs, bro. And everyone's like, oh, yeah. Baseball comes first, man. Yeah. But, like, with esports, to be honest, really, like, and it's just now because of the age group and this bunch of guys in college a lot of times, and it's just now becoming, like, a full-time thing. Most people are like, oh, you're going to go play in a world championship. I don't care. Do your homework and make sure you're staying up on everything else you do because, you know, and if you win that, good for you. But, like, you know, most people are like that now. And now I think we're getting more and more. We're like, all right, yeah, that's a real.
It's legitimate. It's being taken seriously.
It's a really, like, your professors would be like, oh, shit. You know what I mean? Like, if you're like, yo, I'm going to go. Like the kids who won the Fortnite world championships. Like, once he went and won it, one Bugo went and won it, his teachers were like, oh, you get a couple extra days of your homework. You know what I mean? It changed.
Yeah.
I can't imagine, like, the stress and the excitement at the same time. I mean, that's, you're like,
I didn't even care after that, to be honest. Like, when I failed them, I kind of thought I was gonna fail them. When I did, I was like, okay, I was like, whatever. Now it's literally impossible to go to school anyways with, like, you know, moving to your city, and, you know, you could technically do, like, online classes and then not stream at all and not make any YouTube videos or anything, you know?
Yeah.
And then it's just, and then barely, maybe you'd still barely make it, because we have, like, you know, like 10-ish hour days nowadays with our practice and going over VOD, and, you know, so it's kind of tough. That's been on the back burner for a while.
Was this going into summer, or was this, like, the end of, fall quarter or something, or were you, like,
that was actually the ending of my summer semester, because I took my finals like mid-August.
Okay.
Yeah, so, and then after that, I'm like, all right, I'm gonna focus on this, you know. I just made 150k.
There you go.
I'm just gonna chill for a little bit, and then you know, relaxing, streaming, focusing on that.
Do you think that you would, after you'd made that, do you think you would take in a screenshot of it and then post it on Twitter and been like, hey, I just made 150k. This is really cool. Or, like, do you think? I don't know who does that. Like, I don't think anyone.
We posted the big check picture. Our big $600,000 check. That was our.
Big let flex. Them know.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yes.
Flex all day.
Oh, love yeah. It. Of course, poking fun at Playster for that one. That was fantastic. No disrespect to him in advance.
Yeah, his wire transfer, though. He's like,
yeah, that's what I'm saying. He's like, I don't want to flex, but I just made over $200,000.
And also, okay. I'm flexing. This is literally, it couldn't be anything but flexing.
It's literally what you're doing. I can see your bicep. Like, you can't call that not flexing.
Whatever. You got to do, you know what I mean?
That's amazing. So, wait, you won 150 your, like, personally yourself, or was that split?
Yeah, that's each for that one. Yeah.
Bro.
Yeah.
Imagine anyone thinking that that is not legitimate work. Incredible.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely gives you a little head start on stuff.
Oh yeah, dude, that's amazing.
That's sweet.
Guys, just a quick reminder for listeners and viewers: sub to the freaking YouTube, dude. Freaking do it. Not sure why you haven't yet. Sitting there doing nothing, hand on your balls. Go sub to the YouTube. We don't have a special link yet. If you search for "May Contain Action," you'll find it on YouTube. And like I said, follow the Twitch if you haven't already. Let's kick it on over to our lovely producer PM.
What up?
Our game master for the game of the week.
Game
What's up, man?
Master.
I like play that. Game here, by the way, Silly. I think you're gonna
yes,
enjoy
play
it.
Play game.
All right.
If he was like, yeah. No games, dude. No games.
Yeah. Sorry. No games.
Sorry.
No
cap.
Let's
do
it. I don't play games.
I hate
games.
Games are boring. I hate them.
Okay. So real quick, this game. What are we calling it again, Paul? The one that we played last week, like Factor. Like,
Factor or Fiction.
Factor or Fiction. Okay. It's just numbers. So I'm just going to call it Numbers Game. It makes it easier. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to give you one number. Okay. And I'm going to give you two scenarios. And one of the scenarios matches the number and one doesn't. And you have to tell me which one it does. Okay.
All right.
Does that make sense? Okay. Perfect. Sorry. Go ahead, Paul.
I was going to say, it'll make more sense when you do it. Like, it sounds complicated, but it's really simple.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So the first number is 135. Okay. And I should say this, since you are a COD pro, a lot of them are geared towards COD. So there we go.
I lagged a little bit, so I didn't hear any of that.
Okay. So all the questions have a COD aspect to it.
Okay.
Just want to put that out there. Okay. So first number is 135. Okay. Is it the world record for consecutive hours played of one video game, which is Black Ops 2? Okay, so 135. Or is it the length of a water slide where an Idaho college student set a world record by going down it in 10.4 seconds?
Black Ops 2.
Do you have any reasoning for it? Or it's just Black Ops 2.
I feel like I've seen a video of this somewhere, and I feel like it should be within that time range.
Okay.
That's why. But I'm not positive, but I'm still going with Black Ops 2.
Okay, that works.
I'm going to go with the Idaho college student because, remember, I'm a historian on Idaho. We established this last week, even though that bot's gone forever. Yeah, remember, you, there was another thing with Idaho, and I got that right, so I'm just going to say Idaho.
Okay.
I don't even remember what you said happens in Idaho, but it happened in Idaho. So.
Oh my gosh. Was the lottery thing. That's right.
Yep.
That's stupid. I'm going to say COD as well. I think Silly's on to something here.
Okay. So it's Paul 1, Silly 1, Trevor 0.
Fucking suck, Trevor.
The water slide is 100 meters, so I don't think that equates in feet, so I don't know. I'm not even going to try that. But the correct answer is Black Ops 2, 135 hours, consecutive hours played by Okan Kaya in 2012. I don't really want to give him the record, but I'm conflicted because Guinness did allow him 10-minute breaks every hour.
Oh.
But he compiled that in like a 3 or 4 hour period. So like he basically didn't take breaks and then took a nap and then came back. Like he compiled. So I'm not like really on board with it, but that's the world record. So I can't.
That's not real gaming.
Yeah.
What? Nah, you stay there.
If your eyes don't bleed.
You stay there in your sweat and your filth for 3 days straight when the new COD drops. And that's
exactly
to clean 72 hours. No breaks, no sleep.
Maybe a diaper. Maybe.
Monster gaming only.
Maybe. Okay, so yeah. Silly 1, Paul 1, Trevor 0. So next one is 3,200, so 3,200. Is it the number of sales that the Rolling Stones song Gimme Shelter, which we all should have heard by now if we played any Call of Duty, especially Call of Duty Black Ops? Paul, you've heard it. I see your face. You've heard it before. Everyone's heard it. You can play it if you need to hear it. But was that the number of sales that they had after Black Ops release, so 1 week after? Or is it the fine that a U.S. man is facing under Thailand's Criminal Defamation and Computer Crimes Act after he wrote a bad review on TripAdvisor and Google about a hotel?
What was the number again?
3,200.
A fine?
I'm going with the Thailand one because that sounds like, I feel like, probably a pretty hefty amount of money over there, right? Like if you're staying
in
one of the hotels.
It's in U.S. dollars, so I equated it over to U.S. dollars. So just making
sure. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going with that.
Okay.
What do you got, Trev?
I'm gonna go with that too. Valid. I Silly just seems very, very sure. Does he sound sure?
He does seem. He seems very confident in all of his guesses. He exudes confidence. I'm gonna say the made up song by the Rolling Stones. He made
it. The made up song.
That doesn't exist.
I can't play it because we'll get destroyed if we play it. But play the song.
Called Give Thy House. What is it called?
Give Me Shelter.
Well,
give
same
me
thing.
My house.
Yeah, no, I'm going to go with that weird song there. Yeah.
Okay, so Silly 2, Trevor 1, Paul 1. Paul, you lost that one. The actual sales were 11,000, so still pretty significant, but...
that song was made up.
No, it's not made up.
No, it was made up.
But the story about the man, he was arrested on September 12th and released 2 days after posting bail. He wrote a bad review about a $16 corkage fee. But the worst doesn't stop there because now he's facing 5 years in jail.
For a review?
Yep, for a bad corkage review in Thailand. I think the corkage fee is when, like, you buy a bottle and they pop it for you.
Yes, it is.
And it's kind of like the fee of like doing the act.
Bro, Silly is the most cultured guest we've had on this podcast.
I think of course, everyone knows what it is. He's like, I pay the corkage fee every time I go to Sugarfish, dude.
Absolutely not, dude. I got hit with that one time. I think it was we got a bottle of something in our hotel room and they charge us a corkage fee. I'm pretty sure.
Whoa.
Which is complete nonsense. And they won't give you a bottle opener. They'll make you pay so they can do it, so they can charge you for it.
It's shady.
That had to be in Vegas. There's no way it could have been anywhere but Vegas.
It probably was Vegas in Vegas. It probably
was. A lot of restaurants.
$75.
We talked about Nobu. Nobu does it too.
Wow.
I've had the experience out there.
Dude, you know how many companies? You know how many times I've called out United on Twitter for having like a terrible flight service? Like,
yeah,
you
so
can imagine if I got fined for that?
No, 5 years in jail for that.
5 years in jail?
Yes.
Oh my God. United is the worst, by the way. Yeah, go on.
So, no sponsorship from them. Good to hear. All right, next number is 8.8 million, okay? Is it the. So, this is a.
Jeez.
Same question, two different games. So, is it the number of first day units sold for Modern Warfare 3? So, first day. Or is it the first day units sold for Grand Theft Auto 5, which is now 7 years old, by the way?
Grand Theft Auto 5.
Yeah, it's GTA 5.
It's GTA 5.
Remind me not to...
There's just no way Modern Warfare 3 was that exciting. Then again, Modern Warfare 3 was insane. Remember
so,
those?
So you guys both say Grand Theft Auto? Okay, so it's
all
wrong.
All say Grand Theft Auto.
What?
Modern Warfare got 8.8 million first day. It's kind of a trick question. I threw this in there because that was the record until Grand Theft Auto came in with 11.2 million.
They were the longest
withstanding record holder than Grand Theft Auto came in until Molly Walk did. And I think Grand Theft Auto made under a billion in, I want to say, like 3 days.
So it kind of makes sense why they keep just.
Yeah.
Well, they're never going to make another GTA, dude.
Yeah.
Never
they
gonna
are
do it.
Milking the hell out of that thing.
Oh my gosh, it's still
no. They have
milk out.
I bet you they have a decade goal. They're like, we're just gonna drop one with no fanfare, like Apex Legend was. They're just gonna be like, Super Bowl commercial. GTA 6 is out. Go buy it for $300, and then everyone.
That would be sick. Honestly,
interesting marketing plan there.
More companies need to do that surprise drop. Just
surprise
like
drop would
yeah.
be nuts.
Yeah, like don't have any leaks, keep it real tight, and then just drop it. I bet you go crazy. But okay, so 2-1-1. So you guys all have a chance. So Trevor and Paul, you guys have a chance to tie Staley on this last one.
All right.
So okay. I would highly suggest doing the exact opposite. Staley, you're going to go last on this one since you're leading.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
That.
Okay. So
love that.
The number is 13. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Is it the number of pages that Panamanian dictator Manuel Noriega filed in a lawsuit against Activision claiming that the title Black Ops used his likeness without his authority in 2014? Okay. So the pages of the lawsuit. Or is it the number of miles that a message in a glass bottle was found by a kayaker off the shore in Delaware in 1985 that was just returned to the original writer this year?
Whoa.
Number of miles off?
Number of miles off the shore.
What's the number?
13.
13 miles.
13 miles?
No, it's the Panamanian guy.
Panamanian.
Panamanian guy thing. 100%.
Okay.
What are you going with, Silly?
Oh, it's my turn to answer?
No. Paul,
you can't copy me?
Yeah,
no, literally, like, life is going to last every time.
It's either the Panamanian thing or the message in a bottle?
Yes.
Message in a bottle.
Okay.
Lawsuit. My answer, yep.
The correct answer is the lawsuit.
Son of a...
13 miles off the shore. It's literally farther
miles
than you can
off the shore
see.
Very far.
So it's someone in a kayak.
I know!
Like,
it's why it's so crazy.
The land. They can't see land and they're in a kayak. They'd be like...
So, real quick, the bottom
way
one,
too far. There's no way.
The bottom one is hilarious because it's kind of anticlimactic in a sense. It was 2 miles off the shore, and the guy who found it said it didn't travel far at all. He said he found it like 10 minutes after she did it, and then just like waited to return it for years. Like she thought it was just going to be this long process where it was going to come back to her, and the guy was like, "Yeah, no, I've had it this entire time. I just didn't know what to do with it. It was just sitting outside." So it was like very like, oh, that was
romantic.
Waste of my time.
He threw it off the cliff, someone finds it a half an hour later.
I think he said it was like 10 minutes later. Like he almost saw her do it. And he was like, ah, whatever.
Ruin all the fun.
Let it go.
Yeah.
Noriega filed a lawsuit against Activision claiming that Black Ops 2 was so realistic that he believed he was portrayed as the kidnapper, murderer, and the enemy of state who was responsible for the numerous of fictional crimes in the game. And he did not win because he is not a U.S. citizen. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that is the reason for it.
That, guys, so. we can make fun of people as long as they're not citizens.
U.S. citizens.
Yeah. There's nothing they can do about it.
Yes, that's the last one. So Silly 3, Trevor 2.
Still the winner. Champion. Paul took last, as it should be.
Okay, I don't know about as usual.
Everything is right with the world. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. Is exactly everything is where it should be currently right now.
Whatever. You're really dumb.
All right. Last segment before we can let you go, Silly. We like to just, you know, as we are doing our work, not streaming and doing whatever we're doing, we like to have people on the side monitor. We like to give a little shout out to some creator. A creator could be on YouTube, could be on Twitch, could literally just be someone who tweets funny things. Someone that you've been enjoying lately, give them a little bit of love. We'll let you go last. It can be your buddy, it can be someone you play with, whatever it is. But we'll let you go last, let you think about it, and I will start us off. And my recommendation for this week is Cloaksy. You know Cloaksy. Our good friend Dennis, he literally never talks about his sub count. He's always super positive and never complains. I just really enjoy watching. I'm just kidding. I never watch Cloak. Are you kidding me? Like he plays. You can watch him if you want, dude. He used to get carried by Tfue. So
most subversive who I've been watching lately I've ever heard. Incredible.
I just thought since we had a COD pro out of the Cloak's playing COD.
Yeah,
just roast him a little bit on the old pod. But you're welcome to come on and come on the show and just rebuttal me if you want. I mean, whatever. If you're probably sleeping though, so
not invited. Whatever. Great guy though to watch though. Honestly, he's really good. I love that he hides behind his monitor. It's my favorite part of his stream.
My favorite part's half the monitor at the bottom of the camera. It's great.
Exactly.
It's the best.
Incredible.
The quality's
much. Well, I'm going to take this over because Cloak was a terrible choice. My pick of the week is a streamer called Jay Dream. That's JayDreame. I may have shouted him out before, but he's just really doing a great job. Recently been watching more. He is funny. He's good at the game. He plays Tarkov. He's interactive with his chat. He does Bitbot, which is dumb and makes you throw grenades middle of a game, but whatever. I'm actually surprised that doesn't exist more often than COD, but there's probably an anti-cheat against that. Anyway, the point is, he's really creative. He's a really funny dude. He's also very wholesome. And he is twitch.tv/JayDreame. That's Jay Dream. He also has a Twitter at Jay Dream as well. You can check him out there. So he's my call out for the day.
Nice.
Thanks. Thanks, Trevor. Thank you.
Love that. I'll check him out. Silly. Thank you.
There's a lot of big streamers I watch that would be pretty normal for everybody. Shout out someone that I watch all the time that's not like a huge streamer, Frozone, one of the best mouse and keyboard Warzone players. Also from Minnesota, great guy. Give him a watch. He's extremely talented, and make sure to check him out.
Love that.
Frozone.
Yeah. Definitely heard him before. Frozone.
He jumped on scene, right? He plays in a lot of Mercs' gauntlets. I think that's
Oh yeah.
He might have won one with his group. Yeah. And he was like a pretty active member of that. And I think he had a little bit of a following before that, but it's with Warzone, it's really exploded. Yeah. I've checked him out too. I think Tim's played with him a few times in the tourneys too.
Yes.
In the duo tourneys.
Sure.
He seems like a good dude.
Very cool. Awesome. Love that. Who have you been watching lately? We got Jay Dream, Cloaksy, and Frozone. Fantastic. Again, Silly, as we kind of close out here, we want to get to know more about what you maybe have planned coming up. Is there anything that you're excited about? Obviously, there's not really any events coming up anymore, but nothing really to do to stay home. But do you have any streams that you're excited about doing? Any special streams or maybe any special merch or anything you want to give a shout out before we wrap up?
playing in Twitch Rivals with one of my Los Angeles teammates next week. Really excited for that.
Hey.
I have an entire new merch line launching through a partner
Let's
company.
Go.
Gonna be some really really cool stuff. Excited for that, and excited for the actual game to drop.
Let's go. That's right, yeah. Dude, I see the logo in the back and the neon, and I am jealous.
Yeah, it looks a little better with the lights off, so but
I need my logo in neon.
I have a rocker one too around here somewhere.
You can't show that anymore, dude. You can't.
No, I'm not allowed. I know. That's why it's in the closet.
That's why it's in the closet.
Someday when you retire, you can put them all up.
Exactly.
Your entire room covered in neon signs. Sweet.
The graveyard.
Yeah.
Well, dude, Silly, thank you for coming on the pod, man. We really, really appreciate it, dude.
Thanks, bro.
Thank you, guys. Really appreciate it.
Appreciate you a lot.
It was awesome having you here. Actually, I'm going to do this part first. Silly, where can people find you? Where can we find your Twitch stream and all that good stuff?
My Twitch stream is just Silly, S-I-L-L-Y. Twitter, Silly702. Instagram, 702Silly. That's where I'm at most of the time. I'm really friendly. You can always hit me up for anything. DMs are open. Anybody needs anything, feel free to reach out. And see you guys on the battlefield.
Friggin' love that, dude. Oh, this is like the nicest guy we've had on. My goodness. I got it.
And if you get matched up in a pub or in a pub, just carry your damn weight. Thank you.
Exactly.
I got you.
You're too nice. I can tell. So I just thought I'd
Oh, gosh. Last statement here before we head out. Just want to hit you guys with the review of the week. Don't forget, guys, leave a review. 5-star ratings only on Spotify and Apple Podcasts and all those good things. Be sure to hit us with the 5. Leave a review. Let us know what you think of our shows. Today's one comes from Ben. He says, great to have Trev back, I guess, because Trev missed like 5 episodes because he plays baseball, I guess. Listened on Apple, but thought I'd throw a comment over here to make sure it is known how great this episode was, referring to the Milton one. Milton was one of the best guests, and it really feels like the pod is hitting its stride. Keep it up. Ooh. Go Twins. Love that. Hitting our stride. Fantastic. Again, guys, don't forget, you can hop on the podcast by leaving a review. Also, if you have questions for our guests, be sure to reply in the Twitter tweet of who our next guest will be, and you guys can just barely make it onto the pod. All right. This has been the Make It In Action podcast. You can listen on all major carriers of podcasts, including Spotify, iTunes, Google Play, SoundCloud, and watch the VOD on YouTube. Like I said, 5-star ratings only. Leave a review, and who knows, you may be able to hop on the show, and Trevor may butcher your question. Also, go follow at May Contain Pod on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. This has been episode 43.
And before you go, by the way, we have the new banners show live on Twitch. So you don't sub to the show after the fact, and you what?
You cut out like 5 times. No one heard.
Whatever, dude. Click on the one that works best for you below the screen, and sub there too. Don't forget. Thank you.
Love it.
Bye, guys. Peace. Thank you, Silly.
Have a good day. Have a nice day. Peace out, guys.